There's the first extra class on multivariate methods is next week at the location there in the supplies and forces, the new engineering building on the fifth floor. The class will start at 2:30 at the same time. This first class is actually on Tuesday, not on Monday. After the Tuesday class, it will be on Monday. And then I'll have some announcements regarding the So this week I learned a lot. I learned that pancakes taste better if you use buttered milk. And yeah, we use white flour. But also, interestingly enough, white eggs and brown eggs don't need to be freeze. Water boils fast, you get the lid on, and I had a temperature on my stomach to crank up the heat. So you get water faster. But if you add salt to it, it doesn't start boiling any sooner either. I also learned that Pepsi, or any type of pop at room temperature, will make much more foam than if it's chilled. And it doesn't actually matter if the can is shaking or not. So the root fiber is shaking and not shaking, and still get this, roughly, it wasn't a significant effect, which was interesting. The same holds for beer. Cold beer and a cold glass will produce much less foam than warm beer at room temperature. And the high component makes a difference. Some other things are if you drive with your tires inflated and you keep your AC off, you get better gas mileage. Or if you've got a car that's got a two-wheel or four-wheel drive setting, it doesn't really actually make a difference. But they showed an interesting interaction when you are in a two-wheel drive car and your tires are inflated, you get better gas mileage. But by itself, the two-wheel drive and four-wheel drive actually doesn't improve the gas mileage. Hamilton's water has the remarkable ability that you can't dissolve too much salt in it. If you use purified water, you can dissolve much more salt in it, so who knows what's in our water. And if you're growing lentils, like for the Iranian New Year that just passed, you should pre-soak them, keep them in the sun, and water them regularly. And if you use environmentally friendly, or that recycled paper towels, you'll soak your liquid up faster, but it's not going to necessarily hold it in the paper towel. Well, if you lift it off the surface, it will leave part of it behind. Whereas the regular paper towel will absorb it slower, but hold it more. So a lot of this seems obvious, and actually I think next year when I run this, if they ask me to teach this course next year, what I'll do is I'll ask everyone to write down ahead of time what they think the expected effects will be. Because it is true that afterwards you see this written like that, the water boils faster at higher heat with the lid on. That might seem obvious, and with many experiments actually we do have a good notion ahead of time what we expect. But and that's certainly true for the main effect, but what's really interesting are the interactions that sometimes show up. And not just that, it's also the trade-off between the different factors. So if you have three or four factors in your system, they all have different levels of effects. So here's a good study by one of the students in the class. They were looking at gas mileage as well, a different group this time. They discovered that highway driving gives better gas mileage. That's not unexpected. The premium gasoline gives you better gas mileage as well. In this case, the Toyota Echo gave better gas mileage. But what's interesting here is you can see the relative effect. So putting premium gasoline in your car is roughly the same effect as whether you drive on the highway or putting in the city. Or another way to see it is that buying a car such as the Echo gives you way better gas mileage, whether you put in premium gas or not, whether you drive on the highway or not. So this is now really where you can start to see the trade-offs between your system. For example, there might be one factor that can be adjusted more energy efficiently or more profitably. So you would adjust those factors preferentially. So in general, I was really happy with the DOE projects. They were very good. And the grades are already posted on the website where you can see it. I was going to have Emily and Molly talk at the start of the class on their project for DOE. The reason why I've asked them to talk on their project mainly is just to illustrate a bit some of the thinking behind setting up a non-trivial experiment. I think in many of your cases, the experiments were, some of them were straightforward, but also many of you also had experiments that required fractional factorials. But I think Emily and Paul's points a little bit beyond all of that. So I've asked them just to talk for a few minutes about how they set up the experiment and plan.
Okay, hi everyone. So,
yeah.
Sorry. There's no muffin, so sorry to get your hopes up. I'm Holly, I'm a mechanical engineering grad student, and this is Emily, she's a chemical engineering grad student. So our design experiment project was on muffin making. So our objective was to establish which variables have a significant effect on muffin quality. So the four factors we considered were flour type, baking powder amount, mixing time, and operator. So our quality measurement was on a height measurement, so we assumed that the higher muffin would be a better quality muffin, and that was based that a higher muffin would be lighter and fluffier and possibly have a consistent shape. So we measured the muffin height with a digital vernier caliper. So here's just a summary of our four factors. Flour type was used because cake and pastry flour and bread flour potentially have different protein levels, so that could potentially create different structures. Differences in baking powder, we assume that higher baking powder would probably create a higher muffin height. And different mixing times, we need just enough to blend the ingredients, but not too much such that the muffins would become dense. And finally, between us, we possibly have different mixing strength and also different opinions of what blended is. So we wanted to mix until blended, which was kind of subjective.
Okay, so here are some of the disturbances that we had to contend with. I'm going to talk about this bottom section to start off with. So we had a lot of organization happening in the kitchen. To make sure that the raw ingredients were all at the same temperature, we brought them all to room temperature, except we kept the eggs and the milk in the fridge. And for each batch, we take them out and then put them back in. We had enough baking trays so that they had time to cool in between batches, so we weren't reusing a hot tray. We pre-measured everything to avoid a whole lot of washing happening between each batch. And we had everything like super organized on the counter so that when we began batches, and we were doing two batches at a time, we would start the mixing, add the ingredients, mix it up, pour the muffins out, and they went right in the oven. So there was no time elapsed in between the pouring and the baking. And we used a measuring scoop and leveled it off with a knife and then scraped it out with a spatula for everyone, trying to make sure we had the same volume of batter. Also, the very top one of the list, baking time. The baking time, we came upon this problem in the first couple of experiments that the baking time was not going to be the same for every recipe variation. So we decided we'd bake every batch to the same kind of golden color, which was a subjective measurement, and then we'd record the amount of time it took to get to that color. Okay, so this is a test. That top picture is a photo of our preparation of all the pre-measured ingredients. Who can tell me what's wrong with this picture? We're running a half fraction experiment.
A half fraction of the four factors.
Exactly. So if you look, there's 8 coffee mugs and 8 glasses. Mugs have sugar and the glasses have oil. And there's only 7 bowls of flour. So it just happened that as we set it out on the counter, since the bowls were so much lighter than the cups and glasses, that we didn't realize we hadn't measured out the 8. And by the time we got the experiment half done, we had 4 done, then it was obvious that there were only 3 left on the counter. And then we weren't sure what was going on, so we had to tell the bowls of flour apart by the color, because flour actually has a bit of a color difference. And then the last, so we used the 5th one and we re-measured the last 3. This here is a picture of our setup of muffins on a baking sheet. So what we wanted to make sure of was that we didn't confound the order in which they were poured with the location they were at in the oven. So what you're looking at here are 2 batches, and it was randomized who did which batch and which 2 batches were done together. It was randomized which batch went in the front of the oven and which batch went in the back of the oven. And I don't know if you can see, but there's like a parchment paper on top of the baking sheet. We randomized the pouring order against the location in the oven this direction. So this might be pour 1, pour 2, pour 3, pour 4, pour 5, or something like that. And so we randomized that for each runner. We had written those numbers right on the baking, right on the parchment paper, so it was obvious as we were going.
initially we did the half factorial result and we realized that the operator variable was insignificant. So this allowed us to drop it and consider a full factorial. So this was our final model, the Pareto plot, and it determined that the final model significant effects for flour type, baking powder amount, and the interaction of baking powder with mixed neutron. So our model equation is shown up there. Remembering that increased muffin height, we said, was good muffin quality. So the equation showed us that to increase muffin height, we should use bread flour, decrease baking powder, and increase mixing time. So the decrease in baking powder came as quite a surprise. As we stated, we assumed that increases in baking powder would increase the muffin height. We were actually able to find a source that talked about the fact that baking powder actually has an optimum point.
Okay, so so this source, like Holly mentioned, was a book we found in the library at the University of Guelph, and it talked about how how balancing formulas for cakes and muffins was really important for achieving the right shape. And it showed that there is an optimum, and if you're below the optimum, then increasing the baking powder is going to increase the height, which was the result we were expecting. But as you're past the optimum, then increasing the baking powder will actually weaken the internal structure and cause the muffins not to run as high. So it's kind of more like that response surface example where you're on the wrong side of the optimum and so you get a negative slope. So in conclusion, we determined the important factors for making a tall muffin, but these didn't necessarily result in a tastier muffin. In fact, the tallest muffin was the weirdest texture. It was more like a bread texture, not like a muffin or a cake. Organizing and timing was difficult in the kitchen. We recruited an extra person to help us, and still, we were really struggling. One thing was that you can't measure 5 muffins simultaneously with a caliper, so one of them obviously had more chance to cool than the others did. And just like keeping track of the baking time, it was just really crazy. We could have really done with the fourth person. So in the future, if this project was to continue, we could assess muffin quality with a taste measurement. We did do that at the end of our experiment, but we didn't use it in the analysis because it was so subjective and we had 9 different muffins, the original plus the 8, and that's really too many to taste at a time to really objectively. And we could verify the baking powder optimum by trying different levels of baking powder. So here are some pictures. I'm not sure how well they're going to show up, but the tallest one, top right, you can see it looks kind of ugly. It might be hard to see, but what happened was it developed a crust, which rose up, and then it out the side. So it was kind of ugly looking. The best looking down here, they were like really nice golden color with some nice looking cracks in the top, but they weren't the best tasting. The best tasting were kind of more flat, more plain looking, and they looked a lot like the original recipe. Any questions?
Can you tell us, just in terms of preparations, before you even ran the first experiment, how long did you spend deciding on the layout, the randomization, what you were going to randomize, versus the actual time spent executing the experiment?
That's a good question. We probably spent almost the same amount of time, if not more, planning it than actually running it. Running it did take quite a while because we had so many experiments to do, but the preparation, I think, is the most important. And the fact that we made sure to consider everything that could possibly be confounded with each other and randomize that with a random number generator. And even still, we had things like the missing bowl of flour occurred. So
we thought we were really well organized, and there's at least 5 significant things that happened during our experiment that could have affected the outcome.
Anything else?
How did you measure mixing?
So what we did was we stirred the ingredients. We had like 2 sets of the same bowl, the same spoon and everything. And we stirred them until they were well blended. As you mentioned earlier, that was each operator's kind of opinion. Because the original recipe said stir just until blended. So our low level was just stirred until blended. and our high level was dirt until it was blended and set the timer for 30 seconds, and that was the high level.
That's because if we time mixing time, then you could result in not all the ingredients being blended, so you're guaranteed to have a poor quality muffin.
Same with the baking time, right? We had to bake it until it was until it looked done, otherwise we would have a bunch of raw muffins and some that were overdone.
Just regarding the take-home exam, so I assume they're all in. Are they all in? So in this particular question, there was 19 data points. They weren't all orthogonal, so you can't really estimate all two to the four factors in them. You could, but you can't estimate it independently. That's the key point, because your columns in X are not orthogonal. The other main thing about it is you can still learn a lot from this data, even though the experiment wasn't run at the factorial levels. This company was able to build a good model, as you did also, using your main effects and two-factor interactions. So main interactions is a model where there's one term set, four main effects, and six two-factor interactions. So you've got 11 parameters being estimated from your 19 data points. You've still got some degrees of freedom as well to estimate confidence. So the purpose of this question was to build the X matrix and build the Y matrix and solve that for the parameters. And once you have the parameters, you can predict a new value. And this last part of the question is there's really no correct answer. There's an infinite number of solutions that can be used to predict that Y. So typically one way you could do it, you can plug it into something like Excel Solver, or you can set the factors, set certain factors to zero. Because if you looked at the intercept term over here, it was pretty close to the value you needed. Except for C. C cannot be set to zero. C is either minus one or plus one because it's a binary variable. So once you choose C and you go to either one of the levels, then you can start adjusting the other three by trial and achieve the closest that I have possible. Okay, so question two was, I tried to make this as realistic as I could in the sense that there was the trade-off between how many experiments you run, so that's a timing or a budgeting issue, as well as how close can you get to that. So I noticed one or two groups just kind of went away and banged in random numbers all over the place or changed one factor at a time. So that's a pity because you're really kind of wasting your budget on that. You should be doing a fractional factorial, there's three factors, so doing eight experiments right off the beginning is probably not the best way to spend your budget. To do a fractional factorial, then decide on a direction to move in. And that's again, it's not fixed. There's no right answer. It really is process dependent. So some groups took a really big jump, other groups were very, very conservative and moved very slowly. Again, that's a tough one to judge, even on a real point. One thing I'd like to emphasize is to try and reuse points if possible. I'll illustrate that next. And don't resort to this one factor at a time thing. It's really the whole purpose of this course was to at least teach you that. Then there were some, I got some questions like, how do I know that I've reached the optimum? Well, if you take a look at an optimum, it's going to be at a peak. So there's really going to be no main effects close to an optimum. There will be a strong main effect perhaps, but the two-factor interaction and the curvature starts to become far more important at an optimum. So start looking for larger two-factor interactions, or look for the fact that your center point is away from what you would estimate from the limit. So there's the rough optimum. I say it's approximate, about 420 dollars, people take the error that's in the system. Every person has a different error. Also, if you put in exactly 4, 8, and 15, the computer doesn't take it as 4, 8, and 15. It adds a little bit of noise to that to simulate the fact that there's error. So that's what the response surface looks like. So when you started, you were over up here on that flat plateau. And most groups kind of managed to ramp up to the top or got close to the optimum. Maybe that you got stuck on that kind of a little bit of a ridge over there. Or if you want to see it a bit more in quite a different way, that's... So you were out over here, you started over here, and you ramped up to that peak. Now notice here, and this is the one reason why I chose this system, is a very sharp drop-off just on the other side of the peak. Some people kind of did their initial runs here on the corners, and that's really counter to what the question was. You needed to move up the hill, but if you overstepped, you would have fallen off the edge of the cliff. And this is this wasn't done maliciously. I didn't do this to try and trick anyone. It is that many real processes operate in this way, that there is a very sharp optimum beyond which your process becomes really disastrous. And you often get your best optima very close to that cliff. So if you want to see it from the top view, it looks kind of like that. So as you start over here at the bottom, you're approaching up this hill, and then if you overshoot it, you'll fall down on the other edge. Now some groups kind of went up around this edge, some went more direct. So again, like this question, the intention was more on the methodology, not on getting to the peak. So if you log up to the website now, you'll see these grids available. Some sort of clear over here. So it's somewhere over here. And this is actually the data from one of the people in the class. I just took their data points to show here. They started at the baseline, they moved out after their fractional factorials, and notice the points red and black. Moved into this way, so they went 5, 6, 7. They went 5, then 6, and they probably realized they wanted to take a bigger step, so they went to 7. Realized they fell over the edge there and came back to 8, which was actually pretty close to the optimum. And they built a factorial around 0.6. Now notice here how that's quite clever, because they've reused 0.6 as their center point. So you're not using experiments necessarily. Another group actually used 0.5 as one of the corner points and 0.6 as their center point. So they kind of really made most of their data. Then built a CCD design around the edge and built a nonlinear model to then check their next move, and then they placed their optimum kind of around 0.12. And the reason for that is probably the noise in the system. This grid is the noise-free system. So don't be, that's why I say like the optimums give or take 410 and 13. So it's give or take, I think 407, 408, 410. Okay? And then question 3 I'll cover in later on in the class today. How did you guys find this question? Was it okay? Yeah? That wasn't intentional. Okay, so moving on then to the multivariate stuff. So this is page 27. PCA model on a set of data, I'll just recap this again, builds this linear plane for us. This plane is defined by the first component, which goes in the greatest direction of variability. Then the second component, or orthogonal to the first, in the next greatest direction of variance. And then so on. The third component would be in the next direction of variance. And the third component would be orthogonal to the first and the second component. Once we establish where this plane goes, and I think the big question everyone's been asking is, how do you find the components? Everyone, like, what is the algorithm behind it? Now, I'll talk a bit about that in class today. But once we've found these directions, then we do a number of things with the data points. We project these data points onto the plane at a 90 degree angle. So take this data point over here, project it onto the plane, and this is its T1 coordinate. And then each data point would also be a second coordinate. So this is a better example. So this data point projects onto the first component, this distance from the origin to where it meets the line over there, so the T1 value for that observation, and there's a T2 value for this observation, the distance from the origin to where it meets the second. So for each data point, we get a T1 value, a T2 value, T3, T4, and so on. We also get this residual height off the model plane called the squared prediction error. So data points which are close to the plane, they obey the correlation structure being modeled by this PCA model. So the PCA model really is telling us how the system's correlation is. How do the variables move up and down with each other? So a data point that's close to the model plane is well captured by the model. It follows that correlation structure very well. A data point that's off the model plane with high squared prediction error is going to have some inconsistency with the model. Okay? And we ended off the last class by asking, when we see one of these data points that is far off the model plane, in other words, when we find an observation that is inconsistent with the model, which of the variables in the model are related to. So that's what the SPE's contributions here. So here's just what I said there. So if you want to see a visual picture of it, we have our matrix X over there. And within a row of matrix X, we can decompose that into two pieces, X hat and E. So another, I've written it as X minus X hat. Is your residuals, but you can also write it as x equals x hat plus the residuals. So we can see if we take a row from x, we can break it down into two constituent vectors, a row in x hat and a row in e. The row in x hat is the vector on the model plane, so this is on the model plane, and the row vector in e is it tells us how we move off the model plane. So every data point has some combination of both of those. There's a vector on the model plane and there's a vector off the model plane. If a data point is totally on the model plane, in other words, if error vector E over here, the error vector E is just a row of zeros, then squared prediction error is going to be zero. So sum of zeros indicates to us that that data point is exactly on the model plane. It is described well by the model. So when we see SPE that's large, and we have the notion of a 95% limit here, which can be derived. I won't go into how that's derived, but we can get an SPE value. It has quite a weird distribution, which we won't go into in this class. But say, for example, the SPE's 95% limit is 2.5. If we get an SPE value of 6.3, it's well beyond the 95% limit. The probability of it being unusual is very high. Remember, 95% limit says we expect 5 out of 100 data points to be above that limit. Right? It's a 95% limit. In the sense that 95% of the normal variation in your process is below that limit, 5% is above that. So 6.3 is significantly beyond the limit. We need to go and ask ourselves, why is this observation got such a high SPE value? We go back then to this error vector, and we go break it down into its constituent elements, one for each column. So we've got k columns, and we can ask ourselves which of these k variables, so variable 1, 2, and so on, led to this SPE value being large. And those are then the variables we go investigate. Now, from a practical point of view, many times k is in the order of 70, 80 variables for us for a relatively small engineering system. So being able to find the 5 or 6 variables out of those responsible for causing these problems reduces the time we have to go looking at all the data. We just go look at a subset of those. Now, just showing this out in time, this was the data for the temperature example in the notes. This is the limit over here, so the SPE limit in this case is 1.9 or something in that order. And you can go then cross-reference back in your notes why these data points felt above the limit. So this particular point was due to the spike in the data, and this was due to that temperature dip. So it's great from a process monitoring point of view. We often look at the SPE to see when is our process consistent. Remember, data that's below the limit is consistent with the model. The moment we see a data point starting to trend above the limit, tells us, okay, there's an issue with the system. So I'll talk a bit more about monitoring at the end of this class, but one thing we'll often see with engineering systems is SPE is below the limit and then slowly starts to move beyond the limit, indicating to us that some sort of very slow problem is starting to occur on the process. And then we go build those contribution plots over here, using these individual errors to go find out which of the variables are responsible for that drift away from the model. So those are the residuals across the rows. Now, we can also construct residuals for each column in X. So what we're doing here now is, once we've got this error matrix, we can go calculate the sum of squares of the errors in that column. And we can go compare that to the sum of squares that we started off with back here in X. And that relative ratio of the sum of squares, I'll show you now, we just call it R squared, indicates to us how well each column is explained by the model. So if the sum of the errors within this column are small, it indicates that variable particularly well explained. But how small is small? We need to compare it back to something. Right? So we can just, if we just sum the squares of the errors here, we've got very little reference. So what we often do is, remember the R squared value that we define in V squares is simply the ratio between two variances. The numerator's variance is the variability we can explain, and the denominator is our starting point, our baseline. So R squared of 1 indicates then that we've got very good ability to explain something, because the variance on the numerator explained by the model is very similar to the variance that we started off with. In other words, we've got low amounts of error. Or another way to see that is to say the variance of x hat divided by the variance of x. So going back to the picture here, we'll just take the variance of x hat, sum of squares of that vector, divided by the sum of squares of that vector. And that ratio of the two of those two numbers gives us the R squared value. Now we get a zero R squared for that column when there are no components in the model. And that makes sense, because when there's no components in the model, the variance of the X hat, we can't predict anything if we've got no components. So this initially, when you fitted no components to the model, this matrix is just a matrix of zeros, telling us, in other words, that x is just equal to e, would be another way to say it. So with zero components in our system, X hat is a matrix of zeros. So that numerator over here is the zero term. Now we fit one component to this, for example. We go add principal component one. So X hat now, remember X hat for one component is going to be T1, P1 transpose. So we fit one component, X hat now is not going to be negative zero, and these are going to be some non-zero values. Which variables are what explain on that first component? We go take this column and take the variables that are divided by the starting variables. Then we go fit a second component. So plus T2, P2 transpose. Okay? We fit a second component now. So what's happening here is we're starting to trade off. Errors are going to become smaller and the hat is going to become bigger. We're starting to explain more and more variability. With every additional component we add, the errors must become smaller. That's the objective of PCA, is to find those directions that best fit the data. So in other words, with every additional component, the residual error must decrease based on the objective of what PCA is being designed to do. So I'll illustrate that in an example coming up just shortly, but the main point here is these values in X hat start to approach those of X as we fit more and more components, leading to the residuals in E becoming smaller and smaller with each additional component. So if you're looking at the R squared value for each column, it's got to increase with every additional component you start adding. So if you see a sudden jump in R squared, say for the first variable, between components 2 and 3, so you fit two components already to the system, now you're adding the third. If R squared K, for K equals 1, in other words the first column, suddenly jumps up after or between fitting the second and the third component, that gives you an indication that the third component is starting to explain whatever variability is in that first column, in that first variable. So we actually, the way we often use these data, these R squared numbers, is we plot them as bar plots on a component by component basis. So we'll put variable 1, 2, 3, up to K, and we'll plot the R squared value for each component, where the y-axis is the number between 0 and 1. And then as we add the second component, this might only jump up a little, but then for the second variable, really goes up a lot. The third variable also goes up. So this is due to the second component. And there will be some additional R squared going for the last column, and so on. So we can add for the third, and maybe the third column does nothing for this variable, but does bring it very close to the maximum level of 1. So we often plot those sorts of plots for R squared for each column K. So that's for each column in the matrix. So we looked at the rows. The rows are the SPEs. The residuals are actually and this is true for any modeling, in fact. We saw this as well in least squares. The residuals are really often the most important quantity in any modeling work we do, because they indicate to us what structure is still remaining in the data. So the residual matrix, here we look at it line to give us the NDV. We look at it column-wise to give us the R squared for each column. And then finally, we can also just calculate the total sum of squares for the entire matrix X. So this would then tell us how well that model fits the entire data set. And it's done in exactly the same way. We take the variance of X hat. X hat is just TP transpose now. So if we've got several components here, we can write this X hat more compactly as TP transpose. collect all those names and put those vectors together. So the numerator there is the variance of this matrix, which we just take the sum of squares of every element in that matrix, and we ratio it over the variance of the initial X matrix. And like we saw for the individual variables, the same thing is with the whole matrix. R squared has to go up for every single component. With the first component, R squared A equals 0, there's no, that's equal to 0. If we have no components, we can't explain anything at the moment. We'll fit one component, two components, three components, and every successive one of these R squareds is smaller than the previous one. Right? And that makes sense because the first component is defined to go in the direction of greatest variance, so it best explains the data. There's no other direction that vector can be oriented in that will give better explanation of X. So that's why R squared A is bigger than the second component's R squared. When we fit the second component, that variability described by the second component must be smaller than the first component. And then we keep adding components until we get to, if this is in your notes, I don't think this is, but this is a mistake. R squared for the last component isn't 1. The cumulative R squared for all the components is 1, but I'll talk a bit about that next. I'll talk about that. So if we get, just distinguish here between these two cases. So we get R squared when there's 0 components in the model is 0. Then we add a component, and maybe its R squared value is 30%. The second component's variance has to be smaller than this. It can't explain more than the first component. So it would be, say, 20%. But the cumulative R squared would now go 0, 30, 50, and so on. All the way right up until the last component, it would explain, say, maybe 0.1%. Often these last components explain almost no additional variability. But if you go and add up all these cumulative R squareds, it has to add up to 100% at the very end, because the relationship that X equals X hat plus an error, for the very last component, X is just X hat, and there is no error remaining. So then R squared must be, the cumulative R squared must be 0. So there's a distinction between R squared just for that component and then the cumulative R squared. But I'll illustrate that now when this is on. So this looks familiar. This is that spectral data we had in the take-home exam at around the midterm. And I asked then in that exam, how would you deal with a system that has so much data? There's 600 columns of numbers over here, and row-wise there's about 460 tablets. So this is the near-infrared spectrum on each tablet. And this is very common in the pharmaceutical industry. They'll have the tablets being produced, randomly sampled, they have a near-infrared probe, look at that first tablet or at that tablet and generate a complete spectrum from, say, 700 nanometers up to 1,800. And this data only appears for 460 tablets. So each line is a new tablet. And they use this to monitor the processes in control and producing the required tablet composition. So it's a big matrix. It's one of these very short and wide matrices. It has 460 rows. And K is, I think it's about 650. It's in the notes, so I think it's about 650 columns. So very highly correlated data here as well, because the data at wavelength 1,000 isn't very different to the data in the column at the next one over, 1,002. And so on. So we expect very, very high correlation between these x's. Now, if you go fit a PCA model to this data, the first component explains 73% of the total variance. Now, that's pretty dramatic reduction. But just going to redraw this here so we'll get more space. So this is our X matrix. We've reduced it down to a single column called T1. That T1 column captures 72% of the total variance in all the original 650 columns. That's pretty powerful, and it's not uncommon for PCA to have this sort of very, very high dimensionality reduction on spectral data. It's extremely common to see this. With a single component, a single column of 460 numbers, we summarize 73% of the total variability of the original data. There's also, of course, the corresponding P1 vector that goes with that. So we need T1 and P1 to define that first component. So we could write X hat after one component is T1, P1. Okay, so we've summarized X down into a single matrix X hat defined by T1, P1. So the residual variance in P then is the remaining 26%. Now if we go to the, yeah.
I was just wondering about the notation, the large A, small a,
what's the big number? Oh, this should be tiny a. Yeah, that's my mistake. The usual notation is that tiny a runs from 1 to capital A. A is the total number of components you've extracted from your system. And I will talk a bit about that next, or after the break. How do we decide how many components to keep in mind? Yeah. It's the same, we also use tiny k equals 1, 2, up to k. You'll see that all in the notes for the multivariate section. Sorry about that, but this should be tiny a. But this, I don't think this illustration is in the notes. I just think this is small. Okay, so after the first component, we've got 26%. Residual variance in the E matrix. Then we decide to go for the second component. It jumps, the variance increases to 18.5%. So it's explained by the second component. And this is the cumulative R squared. I usually write the cumulative over here, so I haven't in this case. So the second component explains 18.5%. The cumulative variance with T1 and T2 is now 92%. Okay, so we're now adding a second column over here, T2, and it explains 18%. And then the third component, like we added, it only explains 2%, bringing the total variance explained in that table. So then, if we're dealing with the system, you could choose to stop at 2 or 3 components. And often that's done by engineering judgment. I'll talk much more about how to select novel components in the advanced classes on these. It's not really part of this course, but if you decide to stop with 3 components, you would have vectors T1, T2, and T3 that summarize about 94-95% of the variability in the whole system. You would then just deal with those variables afterwards and not really focus on the X variables anymore. These T vectors capture enough of the variability of the original X data that we can then just work in the multivariate world. And that's what I think the aim of this class today is to just really illustrate how once we've calculated the components, we move to a new coordinate system or a new world, the latent variable world, and latent variable coordinate system, and we only plot our data in terms of those T's and in terms of the SP. When we need to interact with engineers on the plant floor, we obviously can't talk to them in terms of latent variables. We can just go back to the exits from that. But initially, we do all our work inside the scores. We monitor the scores, as I'll show today. When we plot our data, we plot plots of T1 versus T2 and color code those plots. And we really focus only on those scores because why bother with the K equals 600 odd columns when we can just deal with the two or three reduced columns that still capture really all the essential variation names. So that's really the theme of today's class. I'll show you about that in different examples. Okay, coming back here to this case study, we've looked at the residuals for the whole matrix. We can also look at the residuals for each column. So I plotted it this way. It's I showed you initially we would typically look at bar plots for when k is in the region of 5 to 20, 30 odd variables. But when k gets bigger than that, we change that bar plot just to a line plot. And that's what I've done with it. So the green line is a number between 0 and 1 on the y-axis here that explains, or shows to us rather, which variables are well explained by the first component. So it's interesting that the first component tends to explain this initial variability at the very, very low wavelengths. And it explains this region at about 1,100 quite well. So the R-squared damage for those columns in the original X matrix is high. You'll see that down here, this R squared is in the region of 0.2. That's a very, very noisy region over here, indicating that there isn't really much systematic variability in the data at that point. The model can't see a direction that best explains that. It's basically like there's just random numbers over here. So there is no direction in which it can go to explain that variance. But this variability right up here, the earlier wavelengths, this it can explain very well with just a single component. And this peak, or this, it's actually this little dip over here around 1,100. That's the area where R squared, just with a single component, is very close to 1 and 0. Adding a second component to the system has to, must, by definition, increase the R squared of every column. At least by a very small amount, or as you can see here in this region, it takes it from about 50% all the way up to 100%. So this region over here, roughly this region, is explained about 60% by the first component, and then all the way up to 100% using the second component. And so on. So we can keep investigating this R squared plot for each column K. Notice what the third component does. The third component in blue here starts to fit this noise. The jump from the black line to the second component to the third component, it goes up by about 20%. But also the third component is responsible just for that region of the spectrum over there. So that's why that third component only explains an additional 2%. First component is 70%. The second component is 20%, so that's this region here and over here. And then that third component going from the black line to the blue line only explains an additional 2% in the model. If we start fitting components after this, this is already at 100%, pretty much all the way up to here. The fourth component is really just going to start fitting noise in that noisy region. And that's how we decided to start fitting components. Now, in many engineering systems, you would have a good feel for the number of components. Because coming back to that distillation column example that we looked at earlier in the class, we said, what are the factors driving the distillation column? It's factors related to the raw material, to the energy input into the column, and so on. Very often we've got a good feeling for how many significant drivers there are in the system. So that would be a good guide to start with. Another way to that gives us some guidance is to look at the total R squared explained. And I'll talk a bit about that in the next session. But before I get to that, let's just wrap up looking at the residuals here for this time the row residuals. So we've looked at the whole matrix. We've looked at the column by column residual, And then finally, we can look at across the roads. So we don't show that as an R-squared value. When we're looking at road residuals, we use this SPE. So after the first component, the green line up here at the top, the SPE numbers are ranging between 10 and 30. As we added an additional component, those points move closer to the model plane. Or, wait, actually that's a bit wrong to say. The points are fixed. What happens is that the model plane gets the second direction, we're starting to fill the plane now, it moves closer to the points. Right? So the residual distance from the plane to the points decreases. And then as we add a third component, we're putting a hyperplane, those numbers come down slightly more. So you should always see that SPE decreasing on a component by component basis. Now what's interesting here is you can also see what the second component is explaining. It's explaining these observations over here, at 90 to 100, as well as around 380 to 400. Because after the first component, their residuals are lower. So we've got some indication that whatever the second component is explaining is important for those observations at that point in time. So just to recap that, the second component explains information around the wavelength 700 to 1100, as well as some of this variability over here. But I would say, in general, the second component is mostly explaining this variability in that wavelength region. But we also see that going from the first component to the second component decreases the SPE values for those observations, as well as these observations. So it indicates to me that those observations have something important going on in that wavelength region. Would be one interpretation. Of course, then you just go verify in the raw data afterwards. But it's just worth looking at these patterns in the SPE plots. Okay, I'll just introduce this final statistic, the t squared value, and the rate. So we've been looking at the residual distances. So the residual distance within a row, which is SPE. We've looked at the columns, and we've looked at the whole matrix. And call that R squared. The T squared value now is a different type of summary of your data. So while the SPE summarizes the error for all the values within the row, T squared summarizes all the components. Now why would we do that? We do that because in some systems we get this X matrix and we extract T1, T2, T3, T4, up to TA. And sometimes TA can be a pretty big number. On some data I've worked with, it's often 8, 9, 10. And so again, we've really reduced our K variables, or K columns of X, down to A variables. But we've kind of landed up again with another combinatorial problem. This time we've got A times A minus 1 divided by 2 score plots to go look at. T1 versus T2, T1 and T3, T1, T4, T2, T3, and so on. So what we do then is we summarize all the T's into a new value called Montelli's T squared, into a single column. So we've got a column over here called squared prediction error. We'll now add a new column, which is over here, called T squared. And these two columns are complementary to each other. I'll show that now. So T squared is defined by this equation over here. So it takes the T value for the ith row and divides it by S1, where S1 is the variance of the entire T1 column. So remember, T1 goes in the direction of greatest variance. We can calculate the variance of this vector, and we'll call that S1, or S1 squared if it's a variance. Not just S1 if it's the standard deviation of T1. So take the T1 value for this row in X, divided by the variance explained. Take the T2 value for the next component, for that same row, and divided by the variance explained by the second component. And we keep going until we divide through by the eighth component and its variance. Okay, so that's all that equation is showing you there. And if you look at that, what it is, it's really the squared distance from the origin to that point. So times t squared is just the directed distance from this origin to that point. Where, remember that this point here is defined by t1 and t2. So it's a distance then. Each of those t's are distances. If we do this squaring and summing, it's kind of like, you can see it as the Pythagorean triangle. We're calculating this distance along the hypotenuse over there. Just for two components, this would be t1. This distance here would be t1. This distance would be t2. So the sum of those distances squared would give us that hypotenuse. But we ratio it divided by the variance explained. So we kind of let each component, we weight it by its variance explained. So we call this, for times t squared is often called the directed distance because it's oriented in those directions. So that's interesting. For every data point in our X matrix, so every observation, I should say, so that row in X, we can calculate its SQV value, and we can calculate the t squared number. So two scalar numbers for every row in X. And they're complementary. SPD represents the distance from this point onto the log plane. Whereas T squared represents the distance from the origin to that point. So T squared, in a way, captures how far along the model plane that data point is moved. And SPE captures how far off the model plane that point is. Now, how would you get a t squared value of 0? What would be the characteristics of an observation or a row in X that would give you t squared equal to 0? Yeah, but what would X be numerically? It would be the mean. So if you had an observation that was exactly at the mean levels, the average values, after we've mean-centered and scaled, this row here would then be zeros. So X would be a row of zeros. If a new row X or a row is exactly at the mean, then its value after centering and scaling is going to be a vector row of zeros. So these t's are going to be t times xp. So that's going to be a row vector t of also zeros. And then when we calculate what times t squared, it's just going to give us a zero value. So an observation with a t squared number of 0 is exactly as you said there earlier, is at the origin of this coordinate system. But what does that mean? It indicates and points at the origin of the coordinate system as its x values or at the average level. So that after we center the scale, that vector comes out to be a row vector of zeros. So what we then do is we plot these t squared values out in a row, in a line plot, much like we did for SPE. We do the same thing for t squared. So t squared is a number, as we said, greater than 0. It's the distance. And t squared also follows an F distribution. So I won't go into exactly how that's derived, but t squared follows an F distribution, and we can calculate, like we did for the SPE, we can calculate the 95% limit or 99% limit, which says below, in this case, the 95% limit, when everything is behaving normally, 5 out of 100 data points will land above this mark. But 95% of the normal operating data would land below that mark. So it's telling us really how far these data points are from the origin of the system. So a point that has a t-squared value above the 95% limit, but with an SPE of, say, close to zero, where would it lie? It could lie anywhere on this model plane, but just far from the origin. So t-squared is just a large t-squared value says your data point is over here, or somewhere over here. It's on the model plane if its SPE is low. Now, a data point can also have, of course, a high SPE and a high t-squared, which just says to us, this data point is totally inconsistent with the model, and its numbers are just far away from the origin, from the center of the system. But often we also get the case, and this often happens in chemical processes, where the process on the T1, T2 plot moves around in time. So it moves around the T1, T2 plot as the system is going. Then something happens that causes it to keep moving beyond the normal limits, but still remaining on the normal plane. What does that indicate? It says, well, it could be also that the system is just moving as it normally does. It's still obeying the model, but the values in that vector are just larger than normal. They're still consistent with each other. The correlation structure is still the same. So the point that's far out of here with the low SPE says the correlation structure is the same because there's no SPE. Remember, that's all that SPE is telling us. It's the data point. Either it has the same behavior or it doesn't have. Either it's consistent with the correlation of all the rest of the data or it's not. So that's what SPE tells us. But then T squared gives us the complementary information of how far from the center of the data point it is. So every data point can be broken down into two pieces, its SPE value and its T squared, and they are complementary in some way. They're off the plane and on the plane. So just to wrap up the section on T squared, and we'll take a little bit of a break here. I'll indicate here is the T1, T2 plot. We can also show that T squared limit as over here, which is happens to come out as an ellipse. How does that happen? Well, if we go back to this equation up there, t squared is the sum of these t's divided by the variance. If we say we're just going to look at two components, then we expand that summation out to just the first two terms. And we can find the 95% limit for that t squared based on this F distribution. And this is the equation of the ellipse, where the ellipse is oriented with the T1, T2 axes. So the major axis is T1 and the minor axis is T2. And every data point that's within this ellipse is below the 95% line over here. Okay, so this is looking at two or three or four or five or six components. However many components go into telling T squared. Like, so in other words, wherever we decide to stop with A, so A, our system could have five components. I'll talk about that after the break. How do we know where A is? But say A is 5, there'll be 5 scores going into this number over here. And that limit is determined by the 5 components. But if we're just looking at 2 components, this ellipse then represents that same horizontal boundary we saw earlier. It's the 95% limit and the 99% limit. Okay, so let's take a break of it for a few minutes. After the we've covered what the multivariate model is, and we've covered SPE and T squared. Just in this last section of this part of the course, I want to just talk about a few other practical points and give some examples maybe. And then after that, I'll talk a bit about that. So we really looked at this idea of pre-processing the data. I'm jumping on to page 32 here. So we've looked at centering and scaling in particular, but there's also a few other pre-processing steps that one can do. Pre-processing in general is modifying that X matrix before you start going ahead with the PCA. So apart from centering and scaling, what we often do is people will put in the transformation of a certain variable. They'll know that the log of temperature is more tightly correlated with one of the other variables than the temperature itself. So if you know that correlation is going to be stronger if you put in the log of temperature, you just take the log of that column and then continue on. Or the inverse of the pressure might be strongly related to something else. Sometimes the square root or the power of 2 or so on. These can all be far more important than the original untransformed variable. So that's just some pointers on that. There's also very common what we do is we add in columns onto the X matrix. So PCA is an excellent tool for handling correlated data and big data sets, so it doesn't hurt adding some more columns on. One thing that's often done is to add on mass and energy balances. So you can use your variables that you measure on your process and from those calculate, say, the left-hand side and the right-hand side of the mass balance or the energy balance and add that in as a new variable because that might be something that's interesting. Remember, what we're doing here is we're adding in things that make our lives easier later on when we're looking at the squared prediction error or the t-squared or the t's. When they go and they become large or they go out of control, we want to be able to interpret them more easily. So if we add in numbers that we can easily interpret, like the heat balance or dimensionless numbers, then that's great, then we should do that. Also, we'll often add in, especially when we're analyzing design experiments using PCA and PLS. That's another great tool to look at DOE data rather than just these squares. You can add in square terms and interaction terms as new columns onto the X matrix. Okay, so the big question we're getting to is how do you calculate this model? The reason why I've been avoiding it is because even just for simple systems with 2-3 variables, you cannot do it by hand. So I'll never ask you in an exam to calculate a PCA model from scratch. It's just a pointless exercise. It's an iterative algorithm usually, even though you plug it in like an eigenvalue decomposition as I'm showing here, it's still behind the scenes when you're asking MATLAB to solve that eigenvalue decomposition. Or when you're doing it in R, for example, there's still some iterative work going on. That's why we don't do it by hand. But just so that you know what's going on here, the eigenvalues and eigenvectors of X transpose X, the eigenvectors are the loadings. So the P matrix is just the eigenvectors of X transpose X. That's why PCA isn't really something new. PCA might be a new sounding thing in engineering, but PCA really is being around for ages and ages. We've known for many years about the eigenvalue and eigenvector decomposition. So if you use the eigenvector in MATLAB and you give X transpose X, you will get as the eigenvectors will be the matrix P that you get from that function in MATLAB. And once you have P, you can say T is equal to XP. And then once you have T, you can go X hat equals TP transpose. And once you have X hat, you can say E, the residuals matrix is X minus X hat. So all of this I describe in the notes further on. But the main point is, how do we get these P's? We've always just kind of put the figure up and said P's go in the direction of greatest variance. Well, they're found by the computer. We would not do this by hand. They come out to be the eigenvectors of the X transpose X matrix. And interestingly, the eigenvalues of these variances are the scores. Another way to calculate is to use the singular value decomposition. So this may not be a topic that's covered in the math course, I'm not sure, but the SVD on an X matrix, so again using MATLAB, for example, you use the SVD function, SVD returns three matrices to you. Singular value decomposition will return mu, sigma, and v. And in particular, u, sigma, and v transpose gives you back your x matrix. You write out those three matrices and multiply them that way, you will get back your x matrix. So MATLAB, you just say, I forget the notation, the square brackets, right? You would just say something like square brackets u s v is equal to SVD of x, and then you will get back those three matrices. Now notice the similarity. If I just write it out this way, this is T T transpose. So U times sigma is your scores, and the V transpose is the same as P transpose. So a different way. Each of these are give you a little slightly different interpretation onto what PCA is doing. If you know about eigenvalues and eigenvectors already, you might learn something about C and PCA from that perspective. If you know a bit about singular values, it's interesting to see that X is just a product of the rotation matrix, a scaling matrix, a rotation matrix. So all that SVD does is it rotates you, your original X's, to a new coordinate system given by the P's. In fact, it just does a rotation and a scaling. That's what U is sigma. Sigma is a diagonal matrix. U is an orthonormal matrix. So if you remember a bit of linear algebra, U is being orthonormal. It's just going to be a rigid rotation to a new coordinate system. Sigma is just going to stretch you out into the direction of those variance. And then P is another rigid rotation. So if you understand that geometry of SVD, I don't expect you to understand it for this course. But if you do know a bit about that from other courses, it gives you some nice insight into what PCA is doing. And then another way you can see PCA is what's called the nonlinear iterative partial least squares algorithm. So the Nepal's algorithm is a well-known algorithm in numerical literature. In fact, it was derived originally, it's called the power algorithm, which is used to calculate eigenvalues. So the Nepal's algorithm is well-known to calculate eigenvalues. It does it one component at a time, and in fact it's very good that way because it calculates the first component, then the second component, then the third component. You get the components in the order of greatest variance. And Nepal will handle this in data, it's iterative, it always converges, it goes slow sometimes. It works beautifully on large data sets. In fact, that's what Google uses, or used at least. I don't know what they use these days, I'm sure they've moved on. But their initial paper, which you can read from Stanford's website, it's available from the University of Stanford, where the two guys wrote how their search engine works. They used millions and millions of rows and columns in that X matrix. And their X matrix is constructed in such a way that it shows the probability of one link from one page being connected to another page. They talk in their paper about how that is a good metric for judging significance of a search query. And the way they solved that, they called their system PageRank, but it is just a Nepal's algorithm. So they were just doing PCA really on a special X-matrix back then. Okay, so that's how you calculate it. How do you know when to stop adding the components? So we've got this notion that X is broken down into several matrices. Vector T1, T1 transpose plus T2, P2 transpose to add our second component, our third component, T3, P3 transpose. And we keep going until we reach the eighth component. How do we know when to stop? Okay, so if you plot R squared for the system, so that first bar over here is the variance explained just using one component. This is the variance explained by the second component. So it explains about 20%, because the first component explains 55%. So jointly, the first two components explain about 75% of the variance, and you add the third, that gives you an extra 10. You get diminishing returns. So like the Pareto plot, just rotated sideways, you may say, I'm going to stop at three or four components. Just visually, a visual judgment. You say, it looks like there's no point in me fitting anything more beyond the fourth or fifth component. So that's one way to judge it. You just plot out the plot of R squared and you decide when you see a significant or diminishing return set. Another way to look at it, and this uses that eigenvalue concept, is that the eigenvalues, the sum of the eigenvalues must add up to k. So that's actually up here at the top. The sum of the eigenvalues will always add up to k. Now, if you write out the eigenvalues from the first component, might be 3.5, then the second eigenvalue is going to be smaller than that, it's going to be, say, 2.4. The third component's eigenvalue will be 1.01, and then the next eigenvalue will be, say, 0.75. A common way to decide when to stop adding components is to say, when my eigenvalue is above 1, I keep adding components. So I will keep the first component, second, third component. The fourth component I will not keep because its eigenvalue is below 1. Why does that sum, why do they do that? Well, let me just move to this board here. They do that because if the sum of the eigenvalues adds up to k, each component, as remember we said, the eigenvectors are the loadings, so the eigenvalues are the variance exponents. So if we have our original X matrix, here's T1, T2, it has its eigenvalue lambda 1. Eigenvalue of the second component is lambda 2. The sum of these lambdas, lambda A, must equal capital K, where K is the number of columns in X. So if a component has a lambda greater than 1, it's adding 1k, or at least 1k of the variance. So if the lambda starts going below 1, it says this component has less weight than a single column from the X matrix. So you're starting to add a component that really isn't worth even a single column from the original X matrix. Conversely, keep adding components as long as these components are worth more than one column from the X matrix. Remember, we want PCA to reduce the number of variables, the number of columns that we have to consider. So as long as lambda is greater than 1, that's a heuristic that's often used. And then the final way to do this, and this is the way most often used in the software, is by cross-validation. So I think I've got a few minutes. I'd like to just illustrate what cross-validation does. It's not in the notes. I will talk about it on the next class. But just to, I'll just give you a diagram for cross-validation. So what cross-validation does is it says, I've got this matrix X. This isn't so important to take down notes, just look at the concept here. So we've got this matrix X, and we say we're going to divide it into G groups. So here's our rows in X. We're going to divide it into G groups, where G, capital G, is usually in the order of 7. So we randomly select, or randomly mark the rows in 7 groups. So what we'll do then is we'll say, well, let me take my first group of X. I'll call this X minus 1. That says, take all the rows from X that I haven't marked to be in group 1. Okay, so that's a little bit weird. Let me put it this way. Imagine we've got 70 rows in X. 70 rows. We divide it into G groups, where G is 7. So each group has 10 rows, and these groups are randomly spread through X. We don't do group 1, group 2, group 3. No, we do, this first row might be in group 1, the second row is in group 6, the third row is in group 3, 4, then 2, and so on. So if I write X minus 1, I'm saying take all the rows from X which are not in group 1. Okay? Build a PCA model of that. So I've build my PCA model there on that, and then I bring in the rows that I excluded initially. Let's call those rows X1. So I bring in my 10 rows that I originally left out. I built my PCA model over here on 60 rows, bring in the 10 rows I didn't use, and find their predicted values of X. Then I build the second model, leaving out rows from the second group. I build another PCA model on that, and I then predict those 10 rows, a different set of 10 rows this time. And you keep going until you reach the last group, you omit the last 10 rows, build your PCA model, then predict those 10 rows from the seventh group. So now you've predicted every row based on a model. So you've actually got 70 rows here. If I join these together, I will have 70 rows of predictions. But the first set was predicted based on this PCA model, this was built on a different PCA model, and so on. So now I've got x hats, and I can then go calculate from this the r squared value. So remember, r squared was the ratio of two variances, the variance of at least x hats. I'm going to just call it like that, for the g group, divided by the initial variance we started with. Okay, so this is a kind of an r squared. It's not a true r squared, because the true r squared is take the pure x hat built on a single PCA model and take the ratio of these. Okay? That's what r squared actually is. Okay? But if I do it in this pseudo way, I'm kind of simulating the testing data and training data. They don't call this r squared, they'll call this q squared. So you will see this terminology sometimes in latent variable models for q squared. It's the cross-validated r squared. And it tries to simulate the fact that you don't have testing data to test this model. So what they'll do is they'll build a q squared model, and they'll keep adding components as long as q squared is increasing. When q squared drops off, that's an indication that you've fitted too many components to the system and you're starting to overfit. You're starting to fit noise and not the systematic structure in X. The reason for that is because every time you do one of these X hats, you're predicting X values on data that was not used to build the model. So you're testing the model's capability here every time. So it's a good strategy to say, as long as Q squared is going up, I'm still fitting systematic variation in X. So you'll see this concept of cross-validation, not just in latent variable models, but in other models as well. And when you see that, all that you have to understand is that it's trying to simulate this testing data strategy. The best way to verify how many components you should use is when you get a data set X, is to keep some of it aside. Fit your number of components and then bring that testing data in, and as long as the predicted performance of the testing data is improving with every new component, you keep going. But eventually, if you bring in a testing data set, what will happen? The Q squared as well. So you'll fit your first component, and you'll get a value of Q squared. Then you bring in your second component, and your third component, and eventually this will start actually dropping off. And in the extreme case where you just keep going, you'll actually not be able to explain much systematic variation at all. So generally, you stop. Over here. So that's in a nutshell what cross-validation is, and we'll go through more in those extra classes. Okay, so just to recap the ways to select the number of components, you can use this eigenvalue heuristic, or you can just plot out R squared. This works well enough in many cases, and then you can put some more sophisticated computer software. Okay, so we've looked at PCA. Now I'm going to look at the extension of using PCA for regression. This is actually a lead-in to a different type of latent variable model called PLS. We don't have time to cover PLS in this course. The PCR gives you really a good enough approximation to PLS in many cases. So you can go today already and go and build a PCR model. We've covered all the tools in this course to do a PCR model. Let's take a look at how we do that. Now, before I get into the mechanics of principal components regression, I'll just take a look at a bit of why we might want to do that. What is so bad about multiple linear regression, MLR? So multiple linear regression, that's the regression we covered in the previous section of this course. Why would we want to go and improve on it? What is wrong with MLR that we need to make some improvements? Let me just illustrate that this way. So in multiple linear regression, you've got this matrix X. Like you did in the take-home exam, you've got your X matrix and you've got your Y matrix, or Y vector. And once you build those two matrices, or X and Y, you can calculate the regression coefficients B. The variability of the regression coefficients is given by the X transpose X inverse times the standard error. Now, this works well as long as this X transpose X is well conditioned. What do I mean by well conditioned? If the columns in X are not very highly correlated, MLR will work fine, and you have no need to resort to any other sophisticated tools. But the problem is, in engineering situations, this X transpose X matrix is very poorly conditioned. When you've got collinear data, you cannot invert X transpose X directly. You'll get roundoff errors and you'll get different solutions if you start tweaking the numbers. So let me illustrate it to you this way. With design of experiments, we have X transpose X. All our columns are independent of each other. We've done full factorial. Now, when you invert that, you can actually do it by hand. But in general, X transpose X is not going to give you a diagonal matrix. Those off diagonals indicate to you that there's correlation between the variables. So X transpose X, we illustrated it when we were looking at the regression section of this course. We illustrated it as once you've got your X matrix, you calculate X transpose X, you'll get a square matrix. The entries on the diagonal represent the variance. So this is the variance of the first column, the variance of the second column, the variance of the third column, all the way up to the variance of the kth column. Off-diagonal elements represent for you the covariance. This is the covariance between the first and second variable, the covariance between the first and third variable. So if the variables are independent of each other, your covariances are going to be zero. But if the variables are correlated, you're going to get non-zeros here. Let's take a look at an extreme example. I'm showing you a case where you've just got two x's, x1 and x2. And these data points are up here. So x1 and x2 is on the lower axis, and then the y value that we're trying to build this predictive model for is on this axis, the vertical axis. Now if I project these data points down onto this x1, x2 plane, you can see the collinearity between x1 and x2. X1 and x2 are strongly positively correlated. Now, what happens is, we're fitting this model plane, y-hat, to this data over here. If these x's are strongly correlated, remember the model plane is being found so that it minimizes the sum of squares of the residuals. If I shift one of these data points just by a very small amount, this plane, through that axial line, will rotate dramatically, just with small shifts, because the objective function is seeking out the point with minimum residual error. So when you've got very highly correlated data, in the extreme case, imagine these data points were exactly on that axial line. I can rotate that plane any way I like, and it will be a valid least squares solution. Okay? If these points are still strongly correlated, but only start moving just a little bit away from that line, that plane can still keep rotating around that axial direction. But that's problematic, because look what they're saying. This, remember, this angle over here, this angle over here, that slope, tells us the slope coefficient V1 for the X1 variable. And this angle over here, of that plane, gives us the angle for the second, gives us the slope coefficient for the second variable. So in other words, V1 over here is this angle, and V2 is this angle for the second variable. So what it's saying is that every time I rotate that plane, I'm getting totally different numbers for V1 and V2. When you've got very highly correlated data, you could get any V1 and V2 values over there, and they would successfully minimize the objective function. That shows up. I mean, we know that our data often are not exactly collinear, but even if they're very tightly collinear, the way that that shows up is that the variance of E is equal to X transpose X inverse times the standard error. What happens is the entries in X transpose X inverse become large, so the variance of B becomes large, because you're getting V1 and V2 values that could be anything. I should have put here, and I ran out of time, unfortunately, to show the opposite case. The opposite case is when X1 and X2 are not tightly correlated. But you can let me try and explain to you this way. If X1 and X2 are not tightly correlated, these data points move and spread all over the plane. That plane is well supported. It cannot just be arbitrarily rotated. But as X1 and X2 numbers become closer and closer and more tightly correlated, that plane can be arbitrarily rotated. So that's a visual way to try to describe why multiple linear regression fails. The primary reason is because you get these unstable solutions for B. And not only that, you can't really use this model very effectively because you can't learn from it. If I just shift the numbers slightly, I'm going to get very different values of B. I will never be able to tell what my slope coefficient means and interpret from an engineering point of view. And that's one of the reasons why we build these models, so we can learn from them. So if I'm getting different values from B every time I make a small change to my data, I'm really not able to learn that. Okay, so what do people do about this problem? Well, they go do things like removing columns from X. So if I know X1 and X2 are tightly correlated, well, I'll say then, I don't need both of them in my model. I'll just remove, say, X1 and build my model using X2. But that's a combinatorial problem. If I've just got two variables, okay, it's easy. But many times we've got hundreds of columns in X. So which ones do you pick to go remove? And then the other problem also comes from the fact that you can't handle missing values. And to me, also a serious issue is the fact that MLR assumes that X has no X has error, but MLR assumes that it doesn't. Okay, so principal component regression is very simple. Like I said, you can do it already. All you do is you take your X matrix and you build a PCA model and you get the scores. And you take those scores and you treat that as your X matrix, as your new set of X's, and you use that to build your MLR, or your normal regression. That solves all your problems. It solves so many problems, I still don't know why people use MLR. This is such a trivial way to build a model and it has so many benefits. But I know why people don't do it. It's because there's a two-step. It's a two-step model. You have to do two separate things to build a single model. And you need some computer software to do it. So the first step is build your PCA model, get your T's, and then your second step is to say, I'm going to build a predictive model where y hat is now tb instead of xb. I replace it with tb. And you can solve that by saying b is equal to t transpose t inverse t transpose y. Now, why does that solve so many of your problems? Well, for one, you your T matrix is the following. Right? Your columns in T are independent of each other. So T transpose T is this. T transpose T is a diagonal matrix. T transpose T inverse is perfectly conditioned. There's no numerical problems with that. Secondly, you can calculate these T's if there's missing data in X. With MLR, you'll see this in socket patches like R and so on. The moment there's a missing value in your X matrix, say over here, R will delete that entire row. All socket patches have to do that. There's no other way that they can deal with it. You can't calculate X transpose X inverse if there's holes in that X matrix. So they'll throw that row out, this entire row. But with PCA, you know that, well, we haven't really covered it in this course, but you can believe me, that Nepal's algorithm can calculate the T1 vector and the T2 vector and so on, even if there's missing data. And then once we have that, well, in the second step, we're using multiple linear regression, and there's no missing values. So that solves the missing value problem. The other problem it solves is the fact that in MLR, we're saying X has no error. When we relate X to Y, the assumption for least squares is that X is measured without error. Well, when we're doing PCR, we're saying T is related to Y. That assumption is still there. We're saying that T is noise-free, but it's a far more accurate assumption because T's have been calculated so that we leave the noise behind. We've said X equals TP transpose plus the E. We've taken our X matrix and we've broken it down into the model, the TP transpose, and into an error matrix E. We've separated the error out of X into that matrix E. And now we're just going on and using that relatively noise-free T to build the MLR. So we're not getting rid of that assumption, we're just making it that we can stay with more certainty that these scores have much less error than the original case. But for me, by far, the greatest advantage of principal interference regression is this free consistency check that you get from the problem. Let me talk a bit about this right now. So let's say we look at T's orthogonal. Oh, okay, and then we have things we don't need to consider for a reason. Okay, let me talk about this consistency check here for a second. What do I mean by that? So you'll see this, I guarantee you will see this when you start working. Your colleagues will have a least squares model built from something, and they will tell you this model works fine as long as you don't extrapolate. And they're right, as long as you don't extrapolate, most models will work fine. But the problem is, they'll say that it will be a case of I've got this x1 variable, that's where we get x1, and I've got my x2 variable, and I've built this least squares model that predicts this y variable from the x1, x2 value. So when they say you don't extrapolate, it just means you can use this model as long as your x1 is between -5 and +6, because that's the region of data you used when you built the model. And as long as x2 is between -2 and +1, your colleagues will say this least squares model will work fine. Because that's again the range where x2 was when the model was built. The problem comes though is when there's correlation between those x variables. If I'm going to make a prediction, if the model was built and this was the relationship between x1 and x2, x1 and x2 are correlated, as you see here in the projection, the same way in the previous plot, right? I'm just showing the projection down onto the plane of the original data point. So the solid points are the original points projected down to the point I'm showing the relationship between x1 and x2. Now, if you bring in a new x1 value, let's say +5.5, and the x2 value is, let's say, -1.8, that's this point you're given by the star. That data point is not an extrapolation. according to their definition of an extrapolation. It's within the x1 boundary, and it's within the x2 boundary. But is it an extrapolation? What would you say about that point given by the star? Given the knowledge of what we covered in content with PCA. You can see that that point's not really in their historical data. So based on that x1 about, I guess, plus 5 or 6, the x2 should be a lot higher. Exactly. So if you had to build a PCA model on that original x data, what would your latent variable look like for the first component? The latent variable for that first component will probably give equal weight to x1 and to x2. But this point here given by the star would have a high SPE. Right, so your first latent variable would go through this direction. We're just building a latent variable on the x data. So this distance here would be your residual distance, the SPE, to that model. So that point is totally inconsistent with the original data, like you said. It should be, for this data point to have a low SPE, that the x2 value should be somewhere over here. But that's the problem. People give univariate limits. They say univariately your x1 must be between minus 5 and minus 6, and univariately it must be between minus 2 and plus 1. That's not true if the data are correlated. If the data are correlated, you have to take that correlation structure into account. And basically, the constraint then is that your new observation must fall close to that line. That would be a more accurate way of saying that what the preconditions are for using this model. So as long as your x1 and x2 value, your new x1 and x2 value that you're going to use in this model, fall somewhere close to this line, sure, then you can go ahead and make the predictions. And you'll be confident that the prediction will be good. But if that point is over here, by the star or that star would be another example, it's uncertain what that value's prediction is going to be. Right? So when people say don't make an extrapolation, well, you really have to take the correlation into account as well, not just do univariate checks on the input data. So I guarantee you will see this when you start working. That people will have these models where they've constructed univariate limits. Now, just want to caution, the univariate limits are fine if the original data spans this whole block. If this whole block was filled with data points when the model was built, then that would be fine. But most times, the x's are correlated somewhat, so you have to take that correlation structure into account. So PCR does this for us for free. We get this free consistency check. As long as we do this two-step model, after we've done the first step, we'll be able to check, is this data consistent with the original x data? How do we do that? Well, we build our PCR model. Now when we want to use it on new data in the future, I talk about this much more on page 41. I give all the steps in the equation. I'm not going to cover it here in the class. But you can go read through it. What you do is, once you get your new x, you first calculate the square prediction error, and you calculate the t-squared value for that x. And if the t-squared value is below its limit, and the SPE is below its limit, then you go on to the second step and get the y-hat. Where you say, y hat is equal to the t vector times b. So in between step 1 and 2, you do this consistency check. As long as the new data are consistent, then you can go on and do the prediction for y hat. Okay? So that's what principal components regression is. It's very simple. It's just PCA first, then least squared second. And that's kind of why I covered this material in the order I had in the course. So that you can do this that yourself. Now, the other latent variable is called projection to latent structures. PLS, and we won't have time to cover that in this course, but I will cover this in the next class. And it's a one-step model that builds a single model between X and Y simultaneously, taking into account these correlations between the X matrix. And it's a slightly better alternative to PCR, though PCR, 9 times out of 10, gives very similar results to PLS. So if you're even if you never will use PLS, at least try to use PCR whenever you have the need for multiple linear regression model, MLR, use PCR first. Another interesting fact about PCR is if you take your PCR model and you fit, so you take your PCR model where it says take your X matrix, calculate your T1, T2, T3, and so on. Then you take these T's and you relate that up to your Y vector. It's important to Y. So you build your MLR model where you've got now this Y vector and this matrix T. So PCR says first do this PCA, then do this multiple linear regression. If you go and extract all the scores so that TA is equal to K. So in other words, you just keep going and adding components, 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 so that you get as many components as there's columns in K. This solution is exactly multiple linear regression, had you just gone directly from X to Y. So that's, conceptually, that's an interesting thing, because it says multiple, says that principal components regression is a subset of multiple linear regression. But it takes care of a lot of the problems that if you had just done MLR together. So the reason for that is simply because we're saying we're using a reduced space. So instead of using all your columns of T, we're only going to use the first 3 or 4 columns. So you're throwing out a lot of the noise, and the noise is not going to have an effect on building the second model document. So conceptually, it's quite nice that way. It's that MLR actually contains PCR, but PCR is often not used because of this two-step. So I would highly recommend it. I do this all the time. PCR gives you a much more stable solution than G-squared by itself. Okay, so just before I cover what's going to be in the exam, I just want to give you a taste for some of other topics of multiple of lazy variables. So I want to just talk quickly a little bit about image data. Image data is always presented to you in a cube. So you've got this cube matrix X. And imagine you've got a digital camera where you've got 3 variables, red, green, and blue. I pulled a few more that I'd say, you just had the first 3. And you took a pixel in that first position. The red pixel says it's a value of 255 in the red layer, and 0 in the blue layer, and 0 in the green layer. That's just the way image data is constructed. It's always numbers between 0 and 255. So for example, a pure black pixel is 000, a pure white pixel is 255, a pure green pixel is 0, 255 in the green layer, and 0 in the blue layer. So when you're presented with this 3D cube and you want to analyze it by PCA, which only works in a 2D matrix, what do we do? Well, we unfold the data. Let's just talk a bit about what unfolding is doing here. So if this is our original image with the 3 layers, red layers, layer 1, green layer 2, blue layer 3, and this is my pixel over here in the top right-hand corner is the first pixel. So top left corner is my first pixel. I'll take that red value and put it over here. The green intensity is here, and the blue intensity is here. Then my second pixel in the first row, I'll put the intensity number for red, green, and blue over there. And so on. And I keep going along the rows. So if I've got I rows in my original picture, and J columns in my original picture, I'll have I times J rows. I'm going to get an extremely long matrix where the first column is going to be all my red pixel intensities, then green, and the second column, and then blue in the third column. And then I do PCA on that. Once I do PCA on that matrix, I'm going to get a score vector. So now you can imagine the case where X after unfolding is this long thin matrix with three columns. I'm going to calculate T1, T2, and I can also calculate SPD. Okay? But because I've got as many observations or rows here as I have pixels in my image, I can just refold the T1 back up again and show it to you like an image. It doesn't make sense to go look at my T1 value. I've got a T1 value for every pixel. So this is pixel in the top left corner. This is the pixel in the first row, second column, first row, third column, first row, fourth column, and so on. Then I've got the pixel in the second row, first column, second row, second column, etc. So if I get the same T1 values, I can just go undo this and show my T1 value. Rather than plotting it as a time series plot, I can show my T1 back as an image for you. And I can show my T2 to you as an image, and I can show SPE as an image. So that's interesting, because if I look at my SPE image, the zero value says that pixel is close to the normal plane. And an SPE with a high value, say over there, is a pixel that's far off the normal plane. And it indicates that there's something different about that pixel. The same way that any SPE value being large would indicate for you that there's something unusual about the SPE. So let me just show this to you in a piece of software which back in the day when I was using MATLAB, I wrote for MACC. So what I'm going to show you here is, I'm going to show you a picture of a piece of wood. So in this picture, there's 345 pixels in the row dimension, 712 in the column. So it's a picture of a board with three channels, red, green, and blue. Here's my original picture of the piece of wood. And this over here is my first component, T1. So T1 is on the right-hand side. And those are small values of T1, those are high values of T1. So the majority of the T1 pixels are low values. And the high T1 pixels are picking up high directions of variability of points that are far away from the model. So these are unusual defects in the wood. So this is a knot over here, and this is some of this black stuff, this gum in the wood. And there's a crack over here that's causing a shadow that's showing up over here. So that's the first component. I can look at my image as a second component. So that's it. What the second component is starting to model is the grain in the wood. And you can see here how this defect has got a high value of T2. So I can see, I could imagine that high values of T2 are related to these darker defects, or that particular dark defect. This defect over here, while visually it has a similar brown color to this defect up here, is actually distinguishable in the T2 plot. In the T1 plot, T1 is picking up these darker defects, picking up this red value, 255 is picking up that split over there. I can also go look at SPE, or the residual half to the first component. So these are numbers between 0 on the model plane, and my highest SPE value is up to 25. So this defect over here in the image has a high SPD value. And this defect has a moderately high SPD value. Now, you can also go and plot T1 against T2. And that's shown over here. So I'm plotting T1 versus T2. And what you're seeing is really a 2D histogram. Up here, this represents the majority of the pixels in my wood. If I go do the following, if I go and click here, it's showing me
we need to change the color of the same thing, so I see it clearly. Can you see those green points over there? I don't think there's really any color I can choose. Maybe blue. Yeah, let's call it this. So if I click on these points, that's where those T1, T2 values are. Okay. Now if I go click on this defect over here, its T1, T2 values are up here. And this defect, T1, T2 values over there. Okay, so this is just a straight mapping between the original data and the score space. You can do that using the standard equation we learned. T is equal to xp. Take my x value, multiply it by p. I get my t value, and this is my t1, t2 score plot here. And you can do some other interesting things, like I can go select all the pixels in this region and ask where are they back in the original image. And let me just change this. So any pixels that are now color-coded white fall under that mask over there. And you can go do things like expand this mask and capture those defects. You'll always land up in that region. In fact, you can put any piece of wood there now, any image of a piece of wood, and its defects will always land up in that region. You can always locate those defects very easily. Another thing is, well, what is this cluster out here represent? This looks like an outlier cluster. So I can go find all the pixels that land in that, that have that particular value of T1 and T2, and they are related to that different type of defect. So this iteration between the score space and the image space is called masking. Whenever I'm moving around in the score space, I'm finding the pixels under this mask back in the score space. And then, I think, yeah, there's this other tool that I had. So if you're not sure what's going on, I can go move this around, and I can go move this around my picture here, and it says all the pixels inside that square are then shown back in this original image. So this is great for finding defects in products. I've used this in some companies where we're monitoring products in real time and finding defects on the surface of the product. Because all those defective pixels, no matter where they are in the picture, will land up in the same space in the score plot. In fact, this software is freely available. You can just go off the AICC website and download it. So it's just a nice little toy to play around with. I think I gave the link in the notes. So if anyone's interested in that sort of stuff, I can talk more about it to them. But the PCA on an image is no different to PCA on the data. You've got your T1, T2 values, you've got SPE, and you can work with it like it's any other data set. Some other neat things you can do with PCA is, and we've looked at this already, in fact, when we were looking at that pastry product. This company here, unfortunately, a lot of the stuff I do, I can't always talk about it directly because I sign non-disclosure agreements, but with this one, I can talk about it, but I have to disguise the data. What happened here was this company was interested in how their product compared to their competitor's product. So what they did is they took the same measurements on their competitor's product and on their own product, and they did a PCA on that. So the purple points represent their batches of product. The green points with the red squares around them are the competitor's product. And what's shown here, so this is the score plot, right? So the purple points are the scores for their values, and the green points are the scores for the competitor's product. The A, B, C, D, E, F are the loadings plot. I've superimposed the loadings plot on top of the score plot. So normally I've shown them to you side by side, but what I've done over here is I've just put the two on top of each other, so that you can interpret them in one go. So you can see, like you should be able to interpret the loading plot already. And you can see that D, E, and F are strongly positive correlated. Those three variables will move up and down together. A will be negatively correlated with C. A will be positively correlated with B. B is also going to have this a negative correlation with C. So they knew all this because A, B, C, D, E, and F were their measurements from their labs. They knew what the correlation structure was. But it's interesting because it says that while they measured six numbers on their product, it's not really a six-dimensional system. It's only a two-dimensional system. So they really only need to, their quality space is two-dimensional and not six-dimensional. That's the first one. Then regarding the competitor's product, well, what would you say the values for D, E, and F are given for their competitor's product? How would you, relative to their product in purple, what would be the typical values for D, E, and F on the competitor's product?
Would they all be below the average of
purple? Yeah, so D, E, and F are in the first direction, in this first component. He's on the positive side of one, so exactly right, the competitor's values for D, E, and F would be below the average level that they operate D, E, and F at. In terms of, it would also be below average for C, right? But in terms of A and B are in the second direction, the second component. We saw this in the pastry example in the previous class, where we have variables in the second component that are independent of the first. And the fact that these points have got a T2 value of plus or minus zero, it's saying that values for A and B for the competitor's product are at average levels. Okay. But what was the most interesting fact for them? They knew that because they measured D, E, and F on the competitor's product, yeah. So they could just see from the raw data that D, E, and F were below average. But you're just seeing that visually in the logging spot. So that's why I call this improved process understanding. You're seeing what you already know, and it's just confirming it. But for them, the greatest insight was the fact that their competitor was able to produce the product so consistently. These are the six final product properties on this product. So the output variables, that this is what they sell this product to their customers as, with these values of A, B, C, D, and E. So their competitor is able to produce the product with far greater consistency than they are able to. And secondly, they can go find out really how to reproduce the competitor's product. It's not hard for them to go do that because you see that there are a few purple points within this region of the competitor's product. So they have produced product in that region before. So it's not hard for them to figure that out. What they originally go do is go to their database for those purple points up there and find the process settings that were used at the time to produce those batches. And that should mimic the competitor's product at the end. So this single plot had a lot of benefit to them. You can learn a lot from these sort of score plots and learning plots. So this is a classic case like you did in the take-home exam. You had to color code your data. So here they've color coded it with the competitor's product versus their own product. We've looked at troubleshooting in the previous class also. I mentioned this case on a refinery in Montreal where there was a problem over here and the plant moved from point A to point C. You can use then contribution plots to find why did the scores move to this new value of T, and find the X variables most related to that problem. So if you're troubleshooting a process, your typical setup is that you build your X matrix with a lot of normal operation, and then you append at the end the problematic operation. So these data points should have high values of SPE and high values of scores. And then you can go use the contribution plots to figure out why. So we'll go through a lot of these examples in the next few classes. Now this plot should be familiar to you guys. This is the take-home exam, the third question. So it was similar. It was a troubleshooting. And we covered this also in the pastry question. I was asking questions like, how is it possible to produce a pastry with such and such a quality variables? In this case, it's just plastic pellets. So what happens here is that the data points in the score sprays that give you poor yield were the ones all up here with low T1 and high T2. What causes an observation to have low T1 and high T2? Well, to get a high T2 value means you've got to have a large size distribution. Those size values are all higher than normal. Or conversely, if the TGA and this other variable, TMA, have lower values. So either one of those or a combination of them will get you a high T2 value. So that's how you can go figure out why you have this problem in the process. You look at the loadings plot with the score plot, or you can just superimpose them like we're using in the loadings plot to troubleshoot why the problem is occurring. I spoke about this issue in the last class. So then just two more applications here was one on predictive modeling or inferential sensors. We've spoken many times about why you would want to build a model for the regression model. And it's usually so that you can predict something that takes a long time in the lab, but you can do it much faster if you've got the real-time data. So here's another case study. This is not my work. I work with Song Moon, who did this work with me. She did all the work, I did the computer program. And it was a very interesting study that she did. She was looking at predicting the seasoning of these chips. So this is this company, Frito-Lay. This work is all published, so you can read about it online. So what Frito-Lay's problem was that they wanted to predict the level of seasoning on the snack in real time. Now, for them to go measure in the lab, they have to go take a sample. They don't actually measure the color of the product in the lab. In the lab, what they do is they dissolve the sample and they measure the level of salt, and the level of salt is proportional to the seasoning. So it's a two-step process for them. But what they did want was a mechanism to be able to predict in real time what the seasoning level was. So Ong Lu used those imaging tools I showed you earlier. What she did, she built a T1, T2 score space. The score space separated the product background, so there's the conveyor belt over here. So this first score space just separates the background from the foreground. Then she takes the image and she divides it into a 20 by 20 matrix. And within each little picture, she builds a piece, or she has a PCA model that predicts the seasoning. So she gets 400 predictions of the seasoning from this. And so from one image, they don't just get a prediction of the seasoning, but they get a prediction of the seasoning variance as well. That actually to them is also very important, is that the snack is evenly seasoned, not just the average seasoning. So that's an interesting way of using it as a soft sensor predictive model. So this was the final setup. The uncoated product goes through this tumbler, the camera's over here, and then after the number is crunched by the computer to predict the average seasoning and the seasoning variance, there's a feedback control loop now. So previously, they had none of this. They had to just take grab samples every few hours and adjust the tumbler settings. Now they adjust the tumbler settings once every 5 seconds for being faster. So they get the process control booting times. Frito-Lay is a remarkable company. They have so much technology on their systems, on their snacking processes. You have no idea how much they invest in something. So it's pretty cool to see how much work they do. And then they're happy to publish it as well. So here you can see what the predictions look like. This was a time trial in the plant at the end. Then there's the error bars for the lab prediction as well as the seasoning predictions from the camera. So the camera's predicting this line, and then these are the lab samples every few minutes. Okay, so there's just one point I want to mention here about using latent variable models for process monitoring. We've looked at process monitoring earlier on in this course, but when the x variables are correlated, there's something that you have to be aware of. So here's two variables, x1 and x2, they're negatively correlated. And I really wish I had a bit more time, but we're running out of time for this class, so I will just go through this quickly. So what happens here is is that same idea I showed you with the least squares prediction, that the engineer is making a mistake, saying as long as it's univariately within the bounds. So here's the second variable is univariately within the Schuart upper and lower control limits. The second variable is univariately within the control limits. But you can see multivariately, the point in green, is outside. It's very different from the rest of the data. So the rest of the data has this negative correlation structure. But this green point, even though it's univariately within the Schuart control limits, so it's down here and up there, multivariately, or jointly, it's out of control and will lead to very different products than the other 49 batches that are over here. So just spend some time going through this figure carefully and the text that I've written over there. But I want you just to understand this point, that when you're monitoring multivariate, you have to use a latent variable model. Don't monitor x1 and x2 independently. Your type 2 error will be high. The type 2 error is where you should have raised an alarm and you don't. That's this case here. You should have raised an alarm for that green point and you didn't. So what we do with latent variable methods is we build a PCA model and we monitor the scores. We monitor the t-squared and we monitor the SQP. Those new variables summarize everything that's going on in the process, but they uncorrelate. The t's are uncorrelated with each other. So you can monitor the t's separately, whereas the x's are correlated. Okay, so I'll just end up with this case study that I showed you early on with the FASCO, and they're melting the steel and they're pouring it out into slabs. And I showed you the screen over here. This was a few weeks back now. So if you remember that they use the screen to determine when there's a problem on the process. And what they're monitoring here, they've called it stability index 1, stability index 2. That's T squared and that's SPD. That's all they monitor. T squared monitors the variability on the model plane, and SPE monitors the variability off the model plane. So the moment their data coming in real time from their process indicates something is inconsistent, this plot will turn red. As SPE gets high, it will turn red. It then shows the contributions to the operator, and the operator can look at the contribution plot and see which variables cause the problem. So it's an extremely sophisticated system because there's a tremendous amount of pre-processing in the X data, but then they're using T squared and SPE. They just don't tell the operators that. They just call these index 1 and index 2. And then they can get the contribution plots. So this has saved them tons of money. We looked at this numbers in the previous parts, but they've been able to ramp up the throughput in their process and save a lot of money on doing that.